Hey y'all, hey, happy Friday. Welcome everyone to Saki Speakeasy Podcast, where I speak easily on various topics that cross my mind throughout the day. I'm your host, Saki Speaks, and I appreciate you giving me your most precious commodity, your time. You guys could be anywhere else right now, but you're here in the Speakeasy with me. So listen, y'all. Show some love and affection, moving in the right direction to my moderators. They are here in the Speakeasy, keeping us safe. So love them up a little bit, please, and thank you. As y'all know, I'm trying to silence my notifications, child. Listen, so we will not be getting interrupted. All right. So please make sure you like, share, comment, and subscribe, which I don't know why you haven't already, but in case you haven't, subscribe to the channel. Okay, make sure you click that notification bell and select all so you'll be notified when I go live. And welcome to my new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to my channel and welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers. All right, so let me see who's here with me today, and hopefully, this will stay focused on the book because y'all listen, y'all know how we do in here. We be reading a book, but we be talking about everything but the damn book. Cause 5 hours last night. I know you lying. Anyway, child. Hey, Kimber. Welcome, darling. Happy Friday to you. Welcome, welcome. I appreciate you being here. Happy Friday, Cindy White. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Hey, learning. Happy Friday to you, dear heart. I appreciate you being here. Welcome, welcome. Listen, look at Choco Chip with the good vibes on a sunny Friday afternoon. Listen, thank you so much for being here. And make sure you be quiet today, girl, because yesterday, Choco Chip said, I can take it, but I don't know what I'm going to do with it. No, God. Welcome back, Choco Chip. Thank you, girl. You the one that started all that shit yesterday. You started it. Hey, Jess Valencia. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome. Wait a minute. She said, Goodwood evening, Saki, and all you pimps, hoes, and hooligans. Wait a Oh my God. No, God. Not pimps, hoes, and hooligans. Lord have mercy. But welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Oh my God. A whole mess. All right. Hey, bikini. That's my little sneaky laughing super sniper right there. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, sis. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Oh my goodness. Listen. Choco Chip says she don't talk a lot, but when she do, honey, like E.F. Hutton, everybody listens. Indeed. Indeed. All right. So let's get into this book, y'all. This book sparked all sorts of conversation yesterday, child. Listen. All right, let's get into it because, child, where do we leave off? Yeah, we made it to the end of it, child. The end of that chapter. I'm hoping that everybody's having a good day, okay? And I'm hoping that y'all are looking forward to a good weekend, honey. And y'all are gonna have a good weekend, cooling out, spending time with friends, family, loved ones, nosy ass neighbors, grandbabies, whoever. Chapter 7. Our senior year in high school rolled around and still no sex. Okay, well, that ain't a bad thing. That ain't a bad thing. We ain't gonna trip on that. Hey, Tracy Cakes, welcome, girl. Happy Friday to you. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Jason and I had been boyfriend and girlfriend for over 3 years, and it was killing me. We did a lot of making out, kissing, caressing, and things like that. He sucked my breasts and fingered me quite often, but refused to stick it in. He kept saying he wanted to wait until we were married. We planned to get married as soon as we graduated, attend the same university, and live happily ever after. All my friends were jealous, thinking I was getting my freak on all the time. But truth be known, I was jealous as hell of them. They were getting sexed better than me. Bruno was still knocking boots with Cordell. Hell, even my mother was getting some. She had a new man, Aubrey, that I had mixed feelings about. I missed my daddy terribly. No one and nothing could ever replace him, but at the same time, my mother deserved to be happy, so I accepted it. Looking back, all the signs of sexual incompatibility between Jason and I were there from day one. I just couldn't see the forest for the trees. Love is indeed blind, and it makes you imagine qualities in a person that don't exist. I used to tell myself that things would change in time. I convinced myself once we became sexually active, our sex life would be the bomb. I was more than ready to spring into action, reading any book or manual about pleasing a man sexually I could find. Part of me wonders whether marrying Jason was the right thing. And I think about how much fun he and I had together, how loving he was to me when my father died, how romantic he was during the years we dated, and it makes it all seem worthwhile. Besides, my love for him is real, and it was the night of our senior prom when I realized that love would never die. I was all decked out in a sexy, strapless red gown with a split going all the way up the back, showing off my well-defined legs. Jason looked too sexy for words in his black tux. My mother had taken some pictures of the two of us in our living room before she rushed off to work. I have something for you. Jason handed me a long, round tube capped at both ends. Color me stupid, but I was expecting a wrist corsage or some typical gift like that. Instead, I got a tube. What's this, baby? I tried to hide my dismay. He saw right through me. Let's sit down for a sec, Zoe. He took my hand, led me to the big, fluffy armchair my daddy used to read to me in as a child, sat down, and then pulled me down onto his lap. Now, boo, open it and see what you got. I popped the cap off the end of the long cardboard tube, becoming more curious by the second. I reached in and pulled out several sheets of paper. It took me a moment to realize they were blueprints. Jason had taken quite an interest in architecture and planned to major in it. Blueprints, baby? He put his arm around my waist, pulled me closer into him, and lightly kissed me on my bare shoulder. Not just any blueprints, spread them open. That's what he said. He helped me to open them up, indeed, and added, I wanted to do something very special for you. Yes, God. For me? Ooh, the plot thickens, indeed, and not just the plot. Anyway, I slipped my tongue into his mouth and gave him a long, passionate kiss. Baby, I didn't realize you actually knew how to draw blueprints already. Well, they're not perfect, nor totally to scale, but yes, I know how to. What are they plans of? I could make out the basic shapes and rooms, but understood blueprints at the time about as much as I understood Japanese. Zoe, these are the plans for our dream house. Word? My smile was hanging so wide open, I looked like I had more teeth than a set of triplets. Word, boo. One day, after we're married, I'm gonna build you this house so we can raise Peter in it and live happily ever after. I threw my arms around his shoulders and hugged him with all the strength I could muster. He started pointing out certain things to me on the blueprints. These are all skylights. Practically the whole house will have a glass ceiling so we can see the stars from every room so we can see our star. That was it. The moment I knew it was forever, three significant things happened after that. We never made it to the restaurant to meet our friends for dinner. We never made it to the prom, and we made love for the very first time. The plans we had for waiting until after marriage became nothing more than a memory. I was so overwhelmed by the blueprints, my heart started jumping out of my chest. It was the single most romantic thing in the world to me. The mere fact Jason had spent so many hours designing the place where he wanted to build a life together made my love and admiration for him even stronger, made my desire to do something just as special for him flourish, made my pussy wet. Jason, I started tugging at his bow tie, trying to get it unfastened. Yes, boo. He grabbed hold of my wrist, trying to get me to stop. What are you doing? We have to meet Brina Cordell and the others at the restaurant in 20 minutes. I got up off his lap and stood in between his legs, carefully placing the blueprints on the coffee table. Fuck them. After grabbing both his hands and pulling him up off the chair, I added, better yet, fuck me. Jason took a double take at me, trying to come up with a response. Zoe, you're tripping. He slightly pushed me aside with his chest so he could make a path to the door. Come on, baby, let's go. We're gonna be mad late. I'm not going anywhere. I finally got up the nerve to stand my ground. I'm not leaving this house until you make love to me. He turned to face me, a perplexed look on his face. Zoe, why are you doing this? We agreed we would wait until after we got married to make love. I walked over to him, reached my hands into the open jacket of his tux and placed them around his waist so I was pressed as close against him as I could possibly get. His body was so incredibly warm, and I craved to feel him inside me. Don't you want me, Jason? I didn't look at him, afraid I might see a look of rejection in his eyes. Instead, I rested my head against his chest, taking special care not to get lipstick on his crisp white shirt. Baby, you know I want you. Don't be ridiculous. As I began to run my fingertips up and down his spine, I lowered my voice to almost a whisper for no other reason than it seemed appropriate at that moment. Then why can't we make love right here, right now? We've waited so long, it's driving me crazy. I know, Blue, but it won't be that much longer. We graduate in a few months. I felt his dick growing in his pants and started hoping he was fighting a losing battle. I still didn't look at him. I could feel his cool breath on the nape of my neck and was just glad he was holding me back. I think about being with you all the time, Jason. I can't concentrate on anything else. I tell you what, why don't we go to dinner and to the prom and see what happens after that? Your mother won't be home until morning, so it gives us plenty of time to be together. That's when I looked him dead in the eyes. You promise we'll make love later tonight? Then the dreaded words escaped his lips. We'll see, boo. I hate the words we'll see. They almost always mean no. My parents spoke those words to me as a child when I asked for a new extravagant toy or dress. They said them when I asked to do something we all knew I had no business doing. Thus, when Jason said them, they cut like a knife. I started crying, and the tears were far from fake. My fragile and oversensitive nature, which had always been present but tripled after the death of my father, came out. I let go of Jason and used my hands to gather up the bottom of my tight dress so I could run up the stairs faster in my high heels. I ran into my bedroom, slammed the door, and flung myself on the bedspread, burying my head into a pillow to catch the tears. He was right behind me. I could hear his footsteps coming down the hall. Jason opened the door, and I could feel my mattress sink farther as he sat down on the bed beside me, seconds before he began caressing my back with his strong, warm hands. Baby, look, if he really means that much to you and you don't want to wait, then sure, we can make love. We can make love right now. I don't want to see you upset like this. It breaks my heart. I turned my head away from him, letting my lipstick smear all over my pillow when I changed positions. Jason, you just don't get it. I shouldn't have to beg you to make love to me. This is supposed to be something we both want. He started running his fingertips through my hair. We do both want this. I was just trying to do right by you and wait. But make no mistake about it, I do want you. I'm not even going to fake the funk about it. After that, we were both silent for what seemed like an eternity. He was running his hands from my hair down to the small of my back, and I was trying to control my sobs, which were eventually replaced with shallow breathing. Zoe, are you okay? Yes, I'm fine. I turned over onto my back so I could look at him. He took the tip of his thumb and cleared the smudged mascara away from my eyes. All of my lipstick had been transferred to my pillowcase. You ready to go to the prom? He didn't answer, but got up and walked over to my bookcase instead, putting on a cassette of slow jams that he'd made for me to remember him by when his parents once took him out of town for a week. He was always such a romantic, making me tapes of love songs, carving our names inside a heart on every tree in his yard and mine, calling me late at night so he could hear me breathe after falling asleep on the phone, letting me wear his varsity basketball jacket. At 6'5", he'd finally stopped grooming and was the captain of the basketball team, taking them all the way to the state finals 2 years in a row. He had the smoothest skin for a man, and he still does to this very day. My husband has always been fine, but he's never been finer than the night we first made love. Dance with me, Zoe. He reached out his hand for me, looking so sexy and debonair as the first song started playing. I took it and let him pull me up off the bed into his arms. We danced, our bodies swaying back and forth slowly in the moonlight, invading my bedroom through the windows. Don't lock that service door, because when Duke come back, he will have to knock. Sorry. Before the first song concluded, Jason traced the contour of my lips with his fingertips, and then our kiss began. We had kissed hundreds of times before, but this one was different. It was as if there was an exchange of souls. We became one entity as our tongues intertwined in a dance of their own. Jason scooped me up into his arms, carried me over to the bed, and laid me down gently. He climbed on top of me, and I pushed his jacket down over his shoulders and off. I love you, Jason. I love you too, Zoe. He took my hand and kissed my palm while I turned on my side so he could easily unzip my dress and slide it over the curves of my body until it was completely removed. The way he undressed me was so provocative. He was so gentle and took so much care with me, like I was a newborn baby. When he was done, I returned the favor. Once we were both nude, we sat on my bed face to face and placed a hand over each other's hearts, feeling the rhythm of our heartbeats coincide. It was the most intense, arousing experience. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the beginning of having tantric sex, but not everybody knows about that. All right. So we started kissing again as he laid on top of me, and for the first time, our private parts brushed up against one another with no clothes in between them. The warmth of his body made my heart flutter and my skin tingle. The anticipation of making love for hours on end was overwhelming. I'd waited so long for the moment to arrive and had envisioned it thousands of times. No, make that millions of times in my mind. I was expecting us to explore every inch of one another with our hands and tongues, make love in every position known to man, and pass out from pure exhaustion. What happened instead was a complete catastrophe. First, Jason got nervous because we didn't have a condom. Zoe, what about protection? It'll be okay. Just pull out real quick when you feel like you're about to come. I was tracing the curvature of his chest with my tongue, knowing my womanhood would finally be endorsed at any moment. I don't know about this, Zoe. Maybe we should wait until we have some protection. He was trying to push me off him, but at the same time, not putting up much resistance to my advances. Jason, do you want me to beg you? Is that it? No, hell no. I started moving my hand up and down the shaft of his thick, long dick and rubbing the pre-cum escaping from the head around with my thumb. I'll make sure I pull out in time. He stuck it in, and it hurt like all hell when my hymen broke. 2 minutes and about 30 pumps later, he pulled it out, and I wanted to scream. I lay there thinking to myself, is this all I get? Jason told me he loved me, and I reciprocated. Then we just laid there in dead silence with his head on my left breast. A whole hour passed, and neither of us mentioned the prom or anything else for that matter. I was depressed, and Jason was. I have no idea what Jason was. I got up and searched through my purse after a cigarette. Smoking was a habit I'd picked up when my daddy died as a method for relieving stress. I was damn sure stressed after my first sexual experience, stressed, disappointed, humiliated, and depressed. Before he drifted off to sleep, he expressed his concern. Sheesh, Zoe, I hope I didn't get you pregnant. Don't be silly, Jason. No way am I pregnant. Never that. That's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. I don't even know what to say. That was some boo-boo. I guess everybody, when they're young, their first time is horrible. Yeah, if they're with somebody their own age who's never done anything, you know. I don't know. Poor things. I don't know what to say. I don't. I have no idea. I'm sorry. She said, glad I caught myself. I wrote Bikini Bottom, Lord SpongeBob on the brain, and I'm sober. Listen, you have no idea how many times I have, just because of familiarity, how many times I've called her Bikini Bottom. Child, listen. Yeah, that was a whole disappointment, Valencia, for real. That was a whole disappointment. Po thing, you know. I don't even know what to say. I'm sorry. A little bit. Hang on 1 second, y'all. You need to put some more salt on that. Sorry, y'all. I'm trying to show my son how to cook something. That's why I said more salt, young man. I always put a lot more salt than that. All right. Pardon me, people, sippers and speakers. All right. Chapter 8. What can I say? Never say never. Whoever said you can't get pregnant by having sex just one time lied like all hell, because my ass sure got knocked the hell up. Ain't that a bitch? In one sense, it really didn't matter all that much since Jason and I were planning to get married in a few months anyway. On the other hand, all the plans Jason and I had precisely worked out for the future went out the freaking window. Everything except the marriage itself had to be reconsidered. I just knew my mother was gonna hit the roof when she found out, but much to my surprise, she informed us that she knew it was gonna happen all along. Jason's parents had pretty much the same reaction. I guess none of them were astonished because they all assumed we had been sexing each other for years and had just been lucky I didn't get knocked up sooner. Our friends all took it in stride as well. From the looks of it, everybody in the world except Jason and I was predicting my impregnation. Good googly moogly. Instead of having an elaborate wedding, we opted for a small ceremony in my mother's backyard the weekend after our graduation from Central High School. I was 3 months and not showing yet. Brina was my maid of honor, and Cordell was Jason's best man. That was the last time I saw the two of them together because they broke up while Jason and I were on our honeymoon. To this day, neither one of them will discuss what happened. Wow. It was a quaint, romantic, and intimate ceremony attended by our families and close friends. Our parents chipped in together and sent us on a week-long trip to the Bahamas as a combination wedding and graduation gift. Our honeymoon turned out to be a culmination of fun-filled days and sexually repressed nights. After prom night, Jason and I never had sex again until after the wedding. To be honest, as much as I craved to be close to him in every way, I wasn't looking forward to another sexual disappointment. On my honeymoon, that's exactly what I got, a series of sexual disappointments, in fact. It is such a strange feeling to love someone more than you love your next breath and yet be appalled when they touch you. Don't get me wrong, Jason never turned me off. He just never turned me on either. Not the way I needed to be turned off. While they say a mind is a terrible thing to waste, they neglect to mention that a body is a terrible thing to waste also, especially when it's a body like Jason's. My husband's past gorgeous and way past fine. In fact, I can't even think of a word that would do him justice. He's a far cry from the little knucklehead I got in a fist fight with the day we met. To make matters worse, he has a scrumptious dick. He just doesn't know how to use it. I had been working after school part-time. At a fast food joint, Jason worked with the county recreation department. We both had plans to attend college, and one of us did, Jason. I chose to pursue full-time employment as an administrative assistant and worked for a dentist's office all the way through my pregnancy. Jason had a full basketball scholarship to state, and we stuck with that plan. His major was architecture, of course. The times he was out of town at away games were dismal, but Rena and my mother tried their best to keep me in good spirits. As horrible as our sex life was, the little bit of satisfaction I was garnishing from being close to Jason was unavailable when he was away. In fact, the further I got into my pregnancy, the more sexually repressed I became, and desperation set in. Simple masturbation was no longer good enough, so I began to play with toys. You name it, and I had it hidden away in a box on a closet shelf where Jason couldn't find it. Everything from a dildo to a vibrator to Benoit balls. My fascination with sex was quickly turning into an obsession. Jason. Yes, boo. He was holding my hand, caressing it gently, and using his other hand to dab the sweat away from my forehead with a moistened towel. Jason. Yes, Zoe. I fucking hate you. I pushed his hands away from me and tried to get up off the hospital bed so I could kick his ass. But the next contraction set in and kicked my ass from the inside instead. Zoe, just calm down and do the breathing exercises they taught us in Lamont's class. He came toward me with all the pampering nonsense again and started taking short, quick breaths as if a demonstration was going to make the pain go away. Jason, I hate you and I hate the fucking doctor and I hate all the fucking nurses. I paused just long enough to clench my teeth and push. The pain was excruciating, 10 million times worse than I ever imagined it would be. I leaned up a little off the pillow, looking like a whale trying to do a sit-up, so I could look my doctor in the eye while he sat between my legs, messing with my coochie-coo. Dr. Henry, I fucking hate you. They all laughed at me, even Jason. The nerve of the bitches. Everyone, including my mother, had warned me about labor. They warned me it was the closest to death a woman could ever come. If they weren't speaking the gospel, then there isn't a dog in the entire state of Georgia. The Lamaze teacher had cautioned all the fathers that their wives or girlfriends might be a bit angry at them during labor. Poor Jason had to feel my wrath because I was past angry. I was ready to kill his ass for putting something so big in me. I was gonna have to rip my ass open to push it out. The Lamaze teacher also told the women to bring a stuffed animal or some other comforting item in the delivery room to soothe their thoughts during labor. Jason bought me a huge stuffed brown teddy and named him Casanova Brown. Jason retrieved it from a chair in the corner and brought it over to me. Look, baby, Casanova wants to keep you company. He started moving the bear around like it was dancing the jig. Trying to focus on the damn thing made me nauseous. I grabbed the stupid ass bear from Jason and threw it so hard it hit a nurse in the head who was walking into the room. Then I slapped Jason upside his fucking head. The rest of the delivery went about like that. I repetitively cussed everyone out and didn't care what they thought about it. It's amazing that even the shyest woman doesn't care how many people are staring at her pussy like a bullseye on a target during labor. At least a dozen people were in and out of the delivery room, and I didn't give a rat's ass. 7 hours and 56 stitches later, unto us a son was born, Peter Jason Reynard, given the first name of my father. Just like Jason and I had always planned. Once I heard all the stats, 6 pounds, 11 ounces, 21 inches long, 10 fingers, 10 toes, and healthy, I was satisfied and passed out. I woke up in the recovery room with Jason rubbing my tummy, probably glad as hell my shape was back, because making love to a blue whale, even for only 2 minutes at a time, must have been kind of frustrating. I love you, Jason. I caressed the side of his face, the same side I had slapped the shit out of during labor with my right hand. I'm so sorry I said I hated you, and even more sorry I hate you. He started laughing. I know you love me, boo, and this is forever. Always has been, always will be. We kissed for a few moments, and then he climbed beside me on the bed, since we could both fit on that bad boy, and fell asleep in my arms. The nurse woke us up a while later so she could check my vitals. After the birth of our son, several landmark events took place in our lives, some very good and some very bad, but together we always came out on top. The first emotional upset came about when Jason's mother found out she had breast cancer. His father retired from a state government job using the early out option, and they moved to North Carolina, where they're both originally from. Then my mother turned around and married Aubrey. I was devastated, but had no choice except to live with it. I didn't have a clue things between them were that serious and was totally shocked when she showed up at my apartment sporting a ring. No sooner had I recovered from that quandary when my boo got hurt in a game and tore the ligaments on his knee to shreds. Instead of having some baby to take care of, I had two. One little and one big. Both of them as cute as they could be. I used to take pictures of Jason and Peter while they were sleeping, the baby lying comfortably on his daddy's chest, their heartbeats as if synchronized. Watching the two of them on the bed together gave me the idea of starting Shades. Shades is my corporation. It started out on a wing and a prayer, but grossed me over $500,000 last year. Listen, businesses start out where you gotta spend a whole lot of money, but if you stick with it, it will eventually make you some money. Hit dogs, don't holler. Anyway, watching my son fast asleep on his father gave me the idea to make my own calendar celebrating the role of the African American father. So many African American women are raising their children alone. It's a blessing to see a man living up to his responsibility. I borrowed some money from a new stepfather who has a small contracting company. Found some people willing to pose for a small stipend and made a calendar for the following year. The cover had a photo of Jason and Peter with bare chests and sporting Atlanta Braves baseball caps. Using the computer Jason's parents bought him for his college studies, I began to advertise them on the internet, and the most miraculous thing happened. They sold like hotcakes. I didn't make a fortune the first year, but I made enough for us to get by between the calendar and my job at the dentist's office. Jason was able to keep his scholarship even though his career as a ball player was over, and the high school we attended, Central, hired him as their head basketball coach. It worked out very well because he could attend college in the morning and coach once school let out in the afternoon. The second year, I put out three calendars, one with African American fathers and children, one with African American families, and an African American swimsuit calendar featuring some co-eds from the university. Business really picked up then. I started my business at a time when calendars that portrayed beautiful African American women were few and far between. It was like selling bottles of ice cold spring water to people stranded in 110 degree desert heat. To make a long story short, every year Peter grew, so did our bank account. We moved out of our apartment and rented a three-bedroom house so I could use one room as a home office. The following year, Jason graduated summa cum laude and got a great job with a top architectural design firm in the city. When Peter was five, Jason kept the promise he made on our prom night and built my dream house. It's a 4,500 square foot, five bedroom, four bath, cul-de-sac in a new development. And it has over two dozen skylights in it so I could see all the stars. We were still decorating when I got pregnant again. When Dr. Henry said the word twins, I wanted to faint, but had to maintain my composure long enough to hold Jason up when he practically passed the hell out. The shock wore off, and the excitement took over. We turned one of the guest bedrooms into a nursery and began shopping for two of everything. Of course, when I went into labor, I was ready to kick everyone's ass again. This time, Jason was prepared for battle and wore a baseball umpire's mask more as a joke than for protection. I must admit, the mask was mad funny and helped keep my mind off the horrific pain. He also brought in reinforcements the second time around, begging my mother to stay in the delivery room and be his tag team partner. Somehow, I managed to push Kyle, Michael, and Kayla Michelle out, instantly making our family unit expand from three to five. After a brief recuperation period, I got back to business and decided to market more than just calendars on the net. I became an African-American arts dealer, marketing all types of artwork from up-and-coming artists who had the vision but lacked the sales ability. Now my art is sold not only on the net but in department stores nationwide. Jason is quickly becoming one of the most sought-after architects in this city and recently made a 5% commission on a $2.1 million office complex. Financially, we couldn't possibly be doing any better, considering we thought all our hopes and dreams were destroyed because of failing to use a condom the first night we made love. And that's the end of that chapter. All right. So what are y'all thinking? Hello. I must be in here by my damn self. It's a 10-second delay. Yeah, he had a good team, but needed a better coach. Okay, child. It's all right. Let me get to the next chapter here. Because I don't know what's going on. There ain't nobody said a word. All right. Chapter 9. I glanced at my watch, noticed it was almost 8 p.m., and started to panic all over again. Marcella, it's getting really late. Jason's going to be worried sick. She glanced at the small crystal clock on her desk. You're right, Zoe. It is a bit late. We've talked a good 3 hours. Yes, I can't wait to see the bill, I chuckled. Whatever it is, it's well worth it. I gathered my purse, coat, and gloves and extended my hand to shake hers. Thanks so much for seeing me, and I'll call your secretary to set up an appointment sometime next week. You in that chair. You're very welcome, and make sure you do that. We shook hands and I started toward the door. We didn't get a chance to discuss the foundation of your addiction, or did we? Not at all. You have yet to hear the truly sickening part. I wanted to make sure you understood my love for Jason, how much he means to me, and why he's my entire life. I lowered my eyes and started fidgeting with my gloves, trying to put them on, but I got the shakes. Now, I have to go home and make up yet another lie to tell my husband. Lie on top of lie on top of lie. That's all I seem to do these days. I realize you have to go, but can I ask one question before you leave? Sure. What exactly do you lie to your husband about? Her eyes widened and she seemed to be waiting to exhale until I answered. I guess the whole thing did seem a bit strange, considering I hadn't actually told her what made me an official sex addict. Well, did I touch upon the fact Jason's not a very passionate or experiential lover, or experimental lover, rather? I asked rhetorically. Yes, I did get that impression. Can't you just try to work on it? It's obvious to me that you love your husband very much. I love Jason more than my next breath. She grinned at me, trying to make me feel at ease. Zoe, just because your husband can't make you see fireworks in bed and you feel your sex life is lacking something, doesn't constitute sexual addiction. I opened the door to her office, took a few steps into the waiting room, and turned to face her. For the first time, I was going to be honest with someone about what I had done. For the first time, I was going to divulge my deepest and darkest secret, one some people knew bits and pieces of, but no one understood the true spectrum of the way I did. If there were even the slightest chance Dr. Marcella Spencer could help me, I had to go for it no matter what the consequences. The alternative was to continue on the destructive path I was on, heading straight to hell in a handbasket. The words were barely audible because I whispered them. Does having three lovers other than my husband constitute sexual addiction? The grin on her face quickly faded and was replaced by a look of astonishment. She was flustered. It took her a moment to gather her bearings while I struggled to hold back tears. We never broke our stare. Yes, I would definitely say that makes you a sexual addict. I figured as much. I diverted my eyes to the door of the waiting room, ready to get the hell out of there before I broke down for real. Look, I really have to go. Jason's gonna be climbing the walls if I don't get home soon. She leaned on the door of her inner office, crossing her hands in front of her. I understand, Zoe. We'll pick up from here next week. Cool. With that, I was gone. I tried to walk away nonchalantly as if I had just told someone about the agenda for the next PTA meeting. Once I got on the elevator and pushed the button for the parking garage, I totally lost it and began wailing like a toddler throwing a temper tantrum. As the elevator descended, I kicked and hit the walls, wiping tears away with the sleeves of my suit and wishing like all hell the whole thing was a nightmare I would wake up from any minute. I knew better. It was all too real, and it was nobody's fault but my own. While I was waiting for my black Mercedes to warm up, I repositioned my rearview mirror so I could take a good look at myself. I wanted to see what a cheating, disgusting, nasty, lying whore really looked like. Behold the whore! I spoke the words aloud and started laughing. There I was, with mascara smeared all over my big brown eyes and tears covering my smooth caramel skin. There I was with ruby red lipstick smudged over my trembling lips. I hated myself at that very moment. I closed my eyes and prayed for someone to throw me a life rope. Zoe, where you been, baby? The dreaded question, and I hadn't even made it all the way in the kitchen door yet. I came into the kitchen where Jason was sitting at the table with the kids eating a chicken supreme pizza from Pizza Hut and threw my briefcase on the countertop of the island. Boo, I'm sorry, I'm getting home so late. I had a problem with one of my distributors and had to hold an emergency meeting. You couldn't call? All sorts of excuses and alibis started running through my mind. I took my coat off and flung it over a stool at the breakfast bar. To be honest, Jason, I got so stressed about solving the problem, the time just got away from me, and before I knew it was after 8. Baby, you have a cell phone. You could have been considerate enough to take one moment out and call so I wouldn't be worried. He got up from the table and started clearing away the dishes, bringing them over to the sink where I was getting a glass of water. I don't understand you sometimes. It's like you don't even care about whether I know where you are or not. Something snapped. Peter, take the twins up to their room and put on a cartoon movie for them, please. I watched Peter gather his siblings up and do as I asked. Thank you. Peter paused just long enough to ask a question. Daddy, can we watch that new movie you bought us, the one with the black Cinderella? Sure, go ahead. Jason was rolling up the sleeves of his white ballet shirt, getting ready to bust some suds. Once the kids were out of earshot, I got back to the matter at hand. Look, Jason, I really don't need this shit from you tonight. I've had a very long day. You keep making it sound like I'm never at home, and that's simply not true. He stood there rolling his eyes, his hands on his hips. That pissed me off even more. Hell, if you had it your way, I would never leave the fucking house. You want me in the kitchen, barefoot and pregnant, huh? See, now you're getting ridiculous. He cut the faucet off and started walking away, mumbling something under his breath, and I followed him into his drawing room. I never implied anything like that, Zoe, and you know it. He bent over, or no, sorry, he went over to the compact stereo system on one of the built-in shelves and turned on a Nancy Crawford CD. He always listens to smooth music when he creates his masterpieces, designing some of the most beautiful and breathtaking buildings one could imagine. You're crucifying me for expecting a phone call, a simple phone call, letting me know what's up. If I did that same shit, you'd never let me hear the end of it. Jason was right, and I was ashamed. Excuse me. Hold on, y'all. Damn. Once again, I was using my own feelings of guilt about my alternative lifestyle as a basis for arguing with him. Before I started cheating on him, we never fought, but the little spats were becoming more frequent. The infidelity had to end. A lesser man would have left me, betrayed me, abused me. Thank goodness Jason's love for me overshadowed his frustration. He sat down at his drafting table and began scribbling, breaking the lead tip out of a pencil by pressing down on it too hard in his anger. I walked up behind him and started massaging his shoulders. I could feel the tension in them, and it made me even more ashamed, knowing I was the cause of it all. I'm sorry, baby. You're absolutely right. I should have called. It was totally irresponsible and inconsiderate of me not to do so. He didn't say a word, just grabbed another pencil and started drawing again. I slowly moved my hands from his shoulders down to his chest and caressed his nipples through his shirt. He grabbed my left hand in his and kissed it. It's okay, Zoe. I just hate it when we fight. I know, boo. So do I. Jason twirled the base of his elevated drawing chair around so he was facing me and looked into my eyes. All I ever wanted to do is make you happy. And you do. You make me very happy. I pressed my palms against his cheeks and gave him a long, wet kiss. I love you, and this is forever. Always has been, always will be. We smiled at each other, and then he started kissing me on the neck while I looked up through one of the skylights at the stars. There was a long, uncomfortable pause. I was trying to decide whether or not I should even mention Marcella. I decided to hint around and see if the shit hit the fan. I met this cool doctor today, a sister. I pushed back a little from him so I could survey his expression. I didn't see a damn thing except the so what look. Her name's Marcella Spencer. Jason picked up another pencil and started fiddling with one of his blueprints. That's nice, honey. I walked over to the stereo and flipped through the CD rack, searching for nothing in particular, but seeing if he had bought anything new. What kind of doctor is she? Jason quizzed. Maybe I can send her some business. Actually, she's a psychiatrist. I waited for the other shoe to drop. Psychiatrist? Jason acted like I said she was a hooker or something, like the word was a four-letter one instead of a 12-letter one. Where in the world did you meet a psychiatrist? Through a mutual friend. That was only a halfway lie. I did hear about her through the lady at the beauty salon. She's very nice and down to earth. Jason chuckled like I had said something funny. Why are you laughing? No reason. It just amazes me that people like that can even make an honest living. He stated emphatically, shaking his head. People like who? Psychiatrists, shrinks, head doctors, he said with an edge of sarcasm. I mean, really, Zoe? What kind of person pays someone to listen to their silly ass problems? Man, fuck you, Jason. I mean, I just took that totally personal. I'm sorry. Anyway, I was offended, but not about to confront him by admitting I was paying and willing to pay out the ass if I had to, if it would help. Lots of people need therapy for different reasons, Jason. I can't believe you're being so close-minded. Well, thank goodness neither one of us is cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, he chuckled, laughing at his own half-ass joke. I would send her some clients if she was an internist or a cardiologist, a pediatrician, or something normal. But a psychiatrist? No freaking way. All my friends are sane. Stressed out? Maybe, but definitely sane. I hunched my shoulders, paced to the window, debating whether to run out of the room before I started crying in despair. How was I ever going to tell him I was seeing a psychiatrist? Guess what, baby? I have some great news of my own. I took a deep restorative breath and turned to face him. What's that, boo? I asked, forcing a smile. He got up, walked over to me, and put his arms around my waist. I got a huge contract today. The city wants me to design the new civic center. Really? I was stunned. I knew my baby was the bomb diggity all along, but he was really hitting the big time lately, having just completed the new YMCA. That's great, baby. We shared a long, passionate kiss. I could feel my panties getting wet. Any show of affection from Jason always turned me on. I have a great idea. What's that? He asked me with a mischievous grin. Why don't you go grab a bottle of champagne while I go upstairs and slip it to something more comfortable? Sounds promising. He gave me a big wet one right smack on the lips. But what about the kids? You know as well as I do, those chaps are probably all passed out on Peter's bed. We both laughed. It was a regular Friday night routine for the kids to all fall out from the past week as if they had worked 12 hours a day. I just want to be with you. I want tonight to be very special. Every night with you is special. I looked into his eyes, wishing things could be different between us. If only he could be more receptive to my needs. I pranced off like Little Red Riding Hood on the way to her grandmother's house, grinning from ear to ear and hoping he was about to portray the part of the big bad wolf and eat me just like the one in the story. I knew there wasn't a chance in hell of that happening, but one can always maintain a strand of hope. I'll see you when I get upstairs. Yeah, okay. That's the end of that chapter. All right, y'all. Anyway. How old were they? How old were who? Oh, I don't know what y'all talking about. So Choco Chip said, I don't seize. You don't seize what? I don't know. I'm looking. Learning said, maybe they should go to sex therapy. Maybe they should. Learning said he didn't seem sexual as a teen. Nope. I think so too. Hey, Marva. Welcome, darling. Thanks so much for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Okay, so Choco Chip said, well, I don't see addict yet. Oh, girl, she's married and she got three sexual partners. Yeah, she definitely addicted. She's definitely addicted. Child, listen. addicted and dissatisfied. She's looking for something. She may not be a sex addict, but she may be using sex to take her mind off of things, which is an addict. But my point is that she it can appear to be a sexual addiction if the partners are basically filling other needs for her. Those partners are filling other needs for her, and they don't have shit to do with sex, but sex is just what she's using to take her mind off of the actual issue. And her actual issue is, well, we don't really fucking know. It could be the death of her father. It could be a whole lot of something. We don't know yet. I don't know. I don't know. I can't even remember the stupid movie. I really don't even remember, child. I remember seeing the movie, but this ain't that. The movie fucking sucked, actually. I was kind of bored and bothered by it, but that's just me. Anybody remember why she was a sex addict in the movie? I don't remember. I don't remember why she was. Is anybody in here a sex addict? Anybody willing to admit that? They're like, hell no. No, I'm not willing to admit that, Saki. Sorry. Listen, somebody just left. It went from 12 people in here to 11. It was like, well, that's my cue to head out. Here she go with the questions, like, I'm out. Oh, well, listen, child. What, Tracy Case? You didn't see the movie, but you read this book? He just seems undersexual. Child. For all we know, something could have happened to his ass. I don't know. Who knows why people aren't interested in sex? Lots of people have different reasons for why they aren't. Could be somebody made them feel bad for having such a huge dick. I know that happened to a couple people I know. Somebody made them feel bad for having such a big dick, and then they was just like, well, I feel all deformed because I got this big ass dick. I'm like, bruh, if you don't shut the fuck up, you'd be surprised. You'd be surprised how many people. No, but if your partner is unwilling or unable, then you will go out and seek other people. Yeah, if your partner can't keep up with you, yeah, you will go out and be with other people because you got to get that itch scratched. All right, so anyway. Can y'all tell I'm a little different today? I just want to know if y'all can tell. I'm a little different today about this book. I don't even know if it's about the book. I'm just different. Oh, God. I'm all different today. It's Friday. All right. I need y'all to, y'all need to win. I seem sluggish. No, I'm not sluggish. I'm annoyed. So I guess that comes off as sluggish, eh? No, I'm not snuggish. I'm not sluggish at all. I'm annoyed. I'm just annoyed. I'll be better later. I missed out on something and it just, it's okay. I'm a little bothered. I'm a little annoyed. I don't really care. I just wanted it to be done. Yeah. Oh, hush, bikini. I am cheered up. I'm cheered up. I mean, I'm in a good mood. She said, yeah, y'all Aquarius, Libras, and Geminis are off balance. Listen. What you're not fixing to do is put an Aquarius in a class with any of the rest of these raggedy ass fucking astrological signs, okay? That's what you're not fixing to do. Could somebody please block Tracy Cakes right quick, please? She says she needs to be blocked. Block her. Block her. I'll buy me another Tracy Cakes. I just went Nino Brown on you, Tracy Cakes. Nah, yeah, it's cool. I am I'm in a good mood. I'm just kind of just like, ugh. I'm like to the universe, come on. But yeah, it's okay. I'm good though. I am. So what does that mean? Being an air sign, you think that means that people are off balance because they're an air sign? No, she's canceled. You could take her face and y'all y'all can run off together. She's canceled. Somebody cancel Treacy Cake. I'll buy me another Treacy Cake. I'll get me another one. I'll just take her grandbaby. He is so cute. Y'all, Treacy Cake's got the cutest grandbaby. God damn, that little baby's just as cute. His smile can light up a room and he ain't even got no damn teeth yet. Good googly moogly. Anyway. Anyway, child, listen. Yeah, I'm trying to get better. I think I'm just a little dehydrated. That's what it is. I'm a little dehydrated. I'm so annoyed I'm dehydrated. It's gonna be better though. I'm drinking my water now. Now look at y'all. Get out of the DMs. I'm good. Jesus. For real, I'm good. I know y'all ain't used to seeing it, but I'm good though. All right, let's get back to the book. Oh my God. Y'all like, wait, what's going on? Are you okay? Oh my God, no. No, I'm serious. I'm good. Right, so let's get back into this book, child, because this is, I need this book to pick up. It ain't enough doing it in here for me. Chapter 10. Just realized. Now we sound like we got a fucking problem. All right, so here we go. When I awoke the next morning, Jason had already left to play his Saturday morning round of golf with his two partners from the architectural design firm. It was after 9. I was surprised all the kids were still asleep, a welcome treat, as normally they would be up at the break of dawn. Rays of sunlight invaded the haven of our bedroom through the skylights in the ceiling. The sun is the only major drawback to having a house with a dozen skylights. It's beautiful, but can become a nuisance sometimes. As long as I get to see my stars at night, it's all good, though. When it rains, it's so sexually stimulating. Then again, most things are sexually stimulating to me. Unfortunately, after Jason and I proclaimed our undying love for one another in his drawing room the night before, it was followed by yet another sexual disappointment. After he fell asleep, I snuck into the bathroom, sat on the countertop, and masturbated with the dildo I kept hidden behind the cleaning supplies in the lower cabinet until I came. Lying there thinking about it was bringing on an episode of depression, so I decided to get up and get moving. I called Brina, my partner in crime, and asked if she wanted to take the kids and hang out someplace for a little while. As expected, she was wide awake and down for whatever. We decided to hook up in about an hour at her place. I took a quick shower and got dressed. I woke the kids, who had all been bathed the night before, got them ready to go, left Jason a note on the fridge, and headed for Brina's. When we got to Brina's, her ass wasn't ready. I could hear the shower running in her apartment as I was knocking. I opted to retrieve the keys she always hid on top of the emergency lamp in the building corridor rather than wait for her to finish. The loafers I had on were killing me, and I wanted to rest my feet for a while. The kids and I bum rushed into her place. I turned on some Saturday morning cartoons for them and went into her bedroom just as she was drying off. Girl, hurry your ass up. She jumped, obviously unaware we were already inside. Damn, Zoe, you scared the hell out of me. Sorry, sis. I didn't mean to freak you out. When she dropped the bath towel to the floor, I was staring at her body. Not because I thought she was sexy. Lord knows I'm strictly dickly. But because her arms, shoulders, and rib cage were all covered with bruises. Ooh, sound like somebody got trophies. I quickly shut the bedroom door, anticipating the highly emotional conversation we were about to have. Brina, are you out of your freaking mind? You're still letting Dempsey's skank ass beat on you? Brina started throwing on clothes faster than a runway model changing clothes between appearances on stage. Zoe, he doesn't mean it. Sometimes he just has a rough day at work and shit happens, you know? Yeah, shit happens. And when I catch up to his ass, he's gonna find out what kind of shit happens when he messes with my best friend. I was fired up. I couldn't believe she was letting his limp dick leprechaun midget ass beat on her. Dempsey was this little trick Brina met at a nightclub, which was hint number one, she didn't have any business with him. Add to that the fact he was unemployed 90% of the time, drank more vodka alone than a Russian football team can drink altogether, and had five kids by four different women, and you have a shitty ass excuse for a man, one of those scrubs TLC is always singing about. A sexually repressed, childish, raunchy, useless bastard. Wow. There you go. Brina was almost completely dressed in a black sweatsuit, comparable to the jeans and cardigan I was bumming around in for a Saturday escapade. I turned on the TV in her bedroom, hoping to drown out our voices even more so the kids wouldn't hear us. Then I got medieval on her ass. Brina, let me tell you something. You're too good for that trick. He's a fucking waste of oxygen. Zoe, look, let's not start this shit again today. Let's just go hang out like we planned. Hang out? We need to be hanging at the damn emergency room. Look at your ass. I walked over to her, attempting to console her, and she flinched due to all the pain the bruises were causing. I took my index finger and pressed it against one of her ribs, and she collapsed on the bed, bent over in pain. Sis, I think your rib is fractured. I reached for the telephone, but she grabbed the receiver out of my hand. Who are you calling? Jason. Hell no. Jason's playing golf and he can't help you anyway. I'm calling an ambulance and then I'm calling the police so you can file charges against this trifling ass nigga. This shit stops right now, today. Brina and I started having a tug of war over the phone and I almost accidentally knocked her upside the head with it before I wrestled it away from her. No, Zoe, you can't call the police. He'll kill me, sis. I hesitated for a brief moment, letting the words sink into my head, and then I replaced the receiver on the cradle. My voice suddenly went from a holler to nearly a whisper as I sat down on the bedside, on the bed beside her. Kill you? She started sobbing, and I got her a tissue off the nightstand. Rena, has he threatened to kill you? No reply. She blew the mucus out of her nose and pretended she didn't even hear the question. Where is he anyway? Dempsey caught the bus home to Alabama for the weekend. It's homecoming at his alma mater. Oh! I didn't know what to say. I was worried about Brina, and at the same time, I wanted to kick her ass my damn self for being so stupid as to stay with him. Part of me wished I knew a voodoo priestess I could call and arrange for Dempsey to be fatally bitten by an Alabama black snake. That would have put an end to it all. Zoe, girl, she jumped up from the bed, walked over to the dresser, and looked in the mirror while she applied some lipstick. Let's just get out of here and enjoy ourselves. It's a beautiful day out, and the kids don't need to be cooped up in here. I picked up the phone again and started dialing. Zoe, I thought I asked you not to call the police. I'm denying whatever you tell them, so it's a waste of time. I'm not calling the police. I'm calling Jason at the country club and telling him to come pick up the kids so I can take you to the hospital. The line was busy, so I pressed down the reset button and started dialing again. Zoe, I'm not going to the hospital either. While it was ringing, I got pissed off for real. Listen, Brina, you may have convinced me not to call the police for now, but your ignorant behind is going to the hospital if I have to rope and gag your ass to get you there. I had Jason paged and I was waiting outside Brina's apartment building when he pulled up in his hunter green Land Rover. After we got the kids buckled in, Jason followed me back up the walkway to the entrance so I could fill him in. He was more anxious to get his hands on Dempsey than I was, but I told him the trick had beat Brina's ass and run like all punks do. We kissed each other goodbye, said I love you, and I watched him pull off with the kids before I went back inside to get Brina. So, where are Jason and the kids going? Home? We were in my car en route to the hospital, and Brina was trying to discuss any and everything but the matter at hand. No, he took them to a family adventure fun park, that place over in SW that has the balls to jump in, crawling tubes, arcade, and all that. Cool. The sun was irritating my eyes, even with the sun visor down, and I was nursing one hell of a migraine. Rena, you do realize you have to end the relationship with Dempsey, right? She rolled her eyes, smacked her lips, and turned the radio volume up to a ridiculous level. Can we just talk about something else, please? Hell no. We're going to talk about this. I turned the radio completely off. That fool has got to stop. He's nothing but bad news. When does this all end? When he uses you as a punching bag one time too many, fucks around and kills your ass? You're tripping hard. You just don't understand my life, Zoe. Then enlighten me, please. I almost ran a red light but was able to screech to a halt just in time. Good thing, too, because there was a police car right behind me. You and Jason have this fairy tale life. You always have had. Shit doesn't come easy to me like that. A good man is hard to find. And you think Dempsey's a good man, Brina? Child, please. He may not be perfect, but he's all mine and he loves me. How can you come out of your face and say he loves you when he gives you a beat down whenever the hell he feels like it? Think what you want, Zoe. He loves me and I love him back. The entrance to the emergency was dead ahead, and I could see the flashing lights on an ambulance that had just pulled in. You need help, Brina. Serious help. And I don't mean the physical kind either. I pondered over Brina's situation as well as my own while I waited for her in the crowded waiting room in the emergency wing. It was flu season, so people were hacking and sneezing, ugh, all over the place. They almost sounded like a snot chorus. It was disgusting, not to mention unhealthy. To most people, I guess Jason and I were living a fairy tale, but they were on the outside looking in. Then again, Jason thought we were living a fairy tale too. I was the only one who could distinguish fantasy from reality. The ironic part is, I had planned to tell Brina about everything that afternoon, asking her to help me overcome my man problems. I was going to tell her how I would leave my house pretending to go one place, but end up someplace where I had no business, committing adultery I never planned on in my wildest dreams. Instead, I was waiting for the doctors to patch her ass up, administer painkillers, and ask her a bunch of questions we both knew she had no intention of answering truthfully, if at all. I decided there was no way Brina could help me when she couldn't even help her damn self, so I decided against confiding in her. I would just pretend to be the happy, successful, content woman she wanted me to be. Ain't that a bitch? This wait is way too long, Brina. I complained, standing near the entryway of the Cheesecake Factory on Peachtree and trying to stay out of the way of people coming in and out. Zoe, I just checked with the hostess a minute ago and she said there are only two parties ahead of us. Calm down. Brina was standing so close to me, I could feel her breath on my cheek. She had the hospital ethyl alcohol bleach smell all over her. We rarely get to hang out anymore, just me and you. You always have the kids with you, so let's just have lunch and catch up. Catch up? I couldn't believe she was putting on a front like we hadn't just left out of the emergency room. The only thing we need to catch up on is why you're still letting that Dempsey maggot open up a can of whoop ass on you whenever he feels like it. She darted her eyes around, embarrassed, trying to make sure nobody heard my last statement. Do you have to talk so loud? I realized I was talking pretty loud, so I toned it down a peg or two. I was still pissed, though. Brina, I have a great idea. Let's just order carry out and head back to your place so we can discuss this openly and honestly without any interruptions. We can discuss it here, she interjected. I don't want to go back to my place right now. I'm sick of being cooped up in there every day after work. Why do you think I'm always so gung-ho about hanging out with you and the kids? My life is mad boring. I was on the brink of insisting that we leave regardless of all that. I just didn't deem it appropriate for us to be there in light of earlier events. Before I could air my objection, they called our name and led us to a table by a window overlooking the Saturday traffic on Peachtree. Once we sat down and ordered a couple of margaritas, I decided to get all up in her business. Brina, why are you so bored? Doesn't Dempsey ever take you out anyplace? She looked astonished, as if the mere thought of a man taking a sister out on an actual date is unheard of in Atlanta. Take me out with what, Zoe? You know Dempsey has trouble holding down a job, and what little money he does make goes to child support. Yeah, child support or liquor, I replied sarcastically. Am I missing something here? Let me see if I have all of this straight. He's a lazy alcoholic sperm bank who comes over to your place just so he can fuck you, beat the shit out of you, and then leave. You just don't understand where I'm coming from, she stated brazenly. Dempsey has a softer side to him that only I see. I chuckled, more out of anger than anything. I couldn't believe my ears. Brina, You deserve so much better than this, but you can't see it for some reason. You and I go way back. I reached over the table and gently took her by the hand. We're like family. You're the closest thing to the sister I've never had, and I refuse to sit back and watch you do this to yourself one more minute. Do what to myself? Allow a man to love me? Her bottom lip started trembling, and so did her hand. She tried to pull it back, but I tightened my grip. Zoe, I'm not beautiful and successful like you. The world is at your feet. You have a badass home, great kids, a mother who actually remembers you exist, and a fine husband who adores you. I wanted to scream out that I was just as tormented as she was, but her problems were more urgent. In fact, they were bordering on life-threatening, so I refrained from discussing my sexual obsession and the effect it was having on my life. I desperately needed to talk to someone. It looked like Dr. Marcella Spencer was my only choice, though. Brina was certainly in no condition to help me sort through my emotions. I'm barely making enough to get by, Brina continued. My mother's always asking me for money. Fuck that whole ass bitch. Stop giving her money. She fucked your childhood up. Anyway, when I'm with Dempsey, it's the only time I truly feel safe. How the fuck you feel safe with a nigga that's busting you upside your head for breakfast, lunch, and dinner? Anyway, no, she didn't just say safe. It's not like I have men knocking down my door these days because you always beat the fuck up. Why would they? You're stuck with a bum. Anyway, I used to, though. You remember that, don't you, sis? You remember when I was beautiful like you? The question is, do you remember, ho? Act like you remember. Do you remember? Jesus, that did it. I squeezed her hand so hard that I practically drew blood. You listen to me. You're still beautiful. You always have been and always will be. I calmed down a little and loosened my grip. I was so upset I had to fight back the tears. Brina was always the confident one. People used to call her conceited in high school, but I would defend her and explain that she wasn't conceited. She was just convinced she had it going on. That Dempsey bastard has destroyed your self-esteem, and I'm not having it. I'll do anything to help you, Brina. Anything. Jason and I both would do anything for you. Don't you know that? She looked me over with the tear-drenched eyes of a child. I know you will, but I can't help you unless you tell me what you need. The waitress came back to the table and asked if we were ready to order our meals. I asked her to give us a few more moments. We had yet to even open up the menus. Once she walked out of earshot, I continued. This is the first time I've heard about any financial problems, Brina. Why didn't you ask me for some money? I could never do that. Why not? That's what friends are for, damn it. I don't want you and Jason giving me handouts. I know how hard it was for the two of you to get where you are. I watched your dreams come true right before my eyes, and I could never take away from that. I mulled it over for a moment in silence. I never realized Brina could be so damn stubborn. Okay, fine. I won't give you anything. I'll make you earn it. Brina looked at me, full of confusion. Come work for me. It's the perfect solution, and we can spend a whole lot of time together. She started chewing on her bottom lip, lost in thought. I don't know about this, Zoe. I don't want to mess up a good thing. I've been at my company for a while now. Well, they ain't paying you no fucking money, so what you messing up, dumbass? And they haven't promoted you, given you a raise, or done a damn thing for you except give you a bunch of aggravation. I smiled at her, hoping to encourage her to accept. Besides, I pay well, and you won't have to fight with me to take vacation time or to leave early or anything. She laughed. That's true. My boss, Mrs. Green, can be a mean old heifer when I ask to leave an hour early. So accept my offer then, damn it. But all I have are secretarial skills. Those aren't all that great. Do you even have an opening at your company in the first place? Nope. But I'll make one up. I'm the owner. I can do whatever the hell I want. She still hesitated. I don't have a personal assistant. I never have had. But now that I think about it, I could surely use one. You could go visit artists with me, hang out at galleries and art shows, do power lunches. You would love it. The waitress came back again, about to cop an attitude since we were taking up table space and not eating. I could understand it. Business is business and tips are tips. The Cheesecake Factory was packed since it was a Saturday afternoon. Excuse me. We finally put the waitress out of her misery, glanced over the menu, and ordered a couple of grilled chicken salads with blue cheese dressing, some cheese toast, and a basket of chicken tenders. Well, I asked, giving Brina my undivided attention while we waited for the food. What's your answer? Let me think about it, okay? Now it was my time to be confused. Think about it. Do you know how many sisters would jump at the opportunity I just offered you? Yes, she replied, giggling, but I failed to see the joke. I'm just not sure I can deal with you as my boss. You're my best friend and all. But I know your temper tantrums better than anyone, and when we get into it, we really get into it. I remember how you and Jason used to go at it all the time when we were kids. I'm offended, I stated, even though she was right to an extent. I'm strictly professional at work. Now, as far as me getting in your ass about trifling things after work hours, that's still a free-for-all playing field. Like I said, let me think about it, Zoe. Either way, thanks for the offer. I wouldn't expect anything less from you. You're always there for me. I dropped it. In fact, I dropped everything. The money issue, the work issue, the Dempsey bastard issue. We enjoyed our lunch and caught up on insignificant things. Once I dropped her back at her place, I asked to use her bathroom before I headed home. I can only imagine her surprise when she discovered the check for $5,000 I left on her vanity. I left her a note saying she better not even mention it, and she better cash it or I would be mad at her ass. I also told her not to dare thank me for it because that's what friends are for, but urged her to give some serious consideration to my job offer. I was hoping she would see things my way and accept. And that's the end of that chapter. All right, y'all. It's 6:08. Let's see. Took 19 minutes to read that chapter. So I'm gonna stop right here because I'm over it. And let me see where we at here. That's what it is, not enough dick. Oh, okay. All hers with four baby mamas, no job, and beat her. Listen. Yeah. So maybe we'll come back later on this evening to read, but yeah, I'm annoyed, y'all. I need a little bit. So I'm gonna stop here, right? I'm gonna come back at 7 o'clock. I think 7 o'clock my time, 8 o'clock Eastern time, 6 o'clock Mountain time, 5 o'clock weirdo time. Yeah, I'll do a kick in the Willy Bobo with you guys. Got a little shit I want to talk about because I'm a little bit annoyed. So maybe after I get all that up off of me, then we can talk about it. Or rather, we can come back and we can come back and do some more of the book because I definitely want to get into the part where people are all, where they fucking and sucking. And yes, Zoe is an awesome friend. Zoe reminds me a lot of myself, minus the sexual addiction thing. Maybe I am addicted, child, but at least my husband is just as addicted as I am. So we just be addicted together to each other. Just stay out of my business, Marva. Marva, why you always in my business, girl? Dang, Marva. Oh, listen. So Valencia said, let's all go have a drink and come back lit. Lit. Oh, my goodness. Child, listen, we in the speakeasy. You're supposed to be having your damn drink in the speakeasy. But listen, yeah, I'll be back. I got to get some things off my chest, in the kick and the Willy Bobo. Yeah, just it's necessary sometimes to just, say what you feel a little bit. So yeah, we're gonna do that. Yes, weirdo time, 5 o'clock, okay? So yeah, that's in roughly 45 minutes, okay? All right, so thank you guys for hanging out with me a little bit. And we'll get back in here one way or another. Oh, no, I'm actually good. I just need to get this up off of me because I'm a little bit, So, yeah. All right. I'll see you guys in a little bit. I love y'all. Please be careful and be back here in 45 minutes. As a matter of fact, look for the damn notification. I'm about to make the screen or the thumbnail, right? So, if you go to my channel after this ends, then you'll see the thumbnail. Give me 5 minutes. It don't even take that long. But yeah, so give me that, okay? And yeah. All right. So y'all be safe and be back here in 45 minutes, okay? I love y'all. Thanks, moderators, for keeping us safe. And if you guys do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. And until 45 minutes passes, I'm out.